I don't know what to think about it. I don't know what that even means.
Hey guys, and welcome to the Social Saint podcast. Quickly, before we go into today's episodes, I just wanted to say thank you for joining us on YouTube. And I'm so excited to have the podcast episodes up here so you guys can see what's going on, see my guests and stuff like that. I also just wanted to let you guys know that the podcasts are now going to be changing schedule slightly. So the episodes are going to come out at the start of the month instead of the end of the month. And the YouTube visuals will be split into two parts. So we'll have like one part come out when the rest of the episode, when the full episode comes out, and then the second part the week after, if that makes sense. So yeah, you can still find all the episodes on Spotify and Apple Podcasts and stuff like that, so don't worry about it. And yeah, make sure you comment, like, subscribe, all of that stuff, and I'm so excited. Bye. Hey guys, and welcome to the Social Saint podcast. We're back and we're on YouTube. Who would have thought? I'm only joking. But yeah, hey guys, we're on YouTube. And if you're listening on Spotify, come watch us on YouTube. I mean, why would you listen on Spotify when you can see my beautiful face too? I'm only joking. But yeah, we're on YouTube now. But I just thought we'd just spice it up a little bit, you know, change things up, you know. And today I have an amazing guest on here. I thought, in honor of the fact that this was the first guest I ever had on the Social Saint, it only made sense to have you on as the first person on the YouTube channel. So I have got my cousin, the Skatefluencer, Devontae Waters.
Hello, everyone. Hey, Ree.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good, man. Feeling really good right now. Obviously, very grateful to be here again with you.
Yeah.
And yeah, I'm really excited to just have a good chat with you and just, you know, it's dive into this conversation, I guess.
Yeah, man, it is. I'm so excited just to have you on. And yeah, like, I'm excited for today's topic. But you've got to talk about what's happened recently, because something crazy's happened. Literally, when I call him a skatefluencer, I'm not joking, guys. He genuinely is a skatefluencer.
I don't even like that word anymore.
I don't even know what it even means. But what happened? Tell the people what went down.
Yeah, so, and I don't know if people know already, but like, I skate. I've been doing quad skating for like nine plus years now.
Crazy.
So it's been a long time, but if anyone follows me on Instagram, they would see that I from time to time, like, post skating videos with just me and my friends on our little street skates or at car parks or wherever we might be. Mm. And yeah, we went on a street skate, me and my boy, PJ, shout out PJ. We was in Streatham and Brixton. Got a few clips of us just doing our thing. Literally, I got home, put it all together in like, I swear, no joke here. It took me like 5 minutes just to put the clips together. Like, it was,
you'd think you'd done some proper editing.
But this is the thing, like, I didn't expect what happened to happen. Yeah, so like, yeah. I just thought, okay, these clips are cool. I put a track on top of it, posted it. And then, yeah, like, basically a couple of days it kind of just had steady growth, like as you would normally. And then by the third day it really like picked up, like loads of people started watching it, the views just kept on amounting up, going up. And then like it got to like 15k views somewhere around there, and I was gassing it. I was like, oh my god, like 15k views, like I've only got like 700 followers, like that's actually crazy.
That's crazy.
And then I literally put a post, I was like, oh, like, can we get, did a screenshot of the views, and I was like, oh, maybe we can get this to 20k. After I posted that, literally the next day it was on like 40 something thousand views, and then from there it just went up and up, like loads of like of them like pages were like reposting it, my followers went up. And then, yeah, as you know, like, we had that conversation, like, oh my god, like, what if it gets to like 250,000?
And I can't believe it.
And then now it's nearly on 500,000.
It's just insane.
Incredible.
But that's just the way that things are working now with like Instagram and TikTok. It's like all these quick, short videos.
Yeah.
And they just get crazy views sometimes.
And I think that's kind of the exciting thing for me, because I've been skating for a long time and like, nothing was really coming out of it. I was literally just doing it because I just love doing it. Do you know what I mean? But now, obviously, with that video and the attention really is on skating this summer. Like, I genuinely feel like this summer, the quad skating is just going to be crazy.
Yeah, it is. I think every, especially after last summer with that girl that did that, you know, that girl in the yellow.
Umi.
Yeah, Umi. I don't know. Yeah, I think it's Umi or something like that. She did like that video, that short clip. I think she was from Germany and she's like wearing like yellow shorts and a top. I think like everyone saw it.
Everyone's seen that video.
Like skating, turning. And I feel like that just after that, everyone was just inspired, right? I'm going to get skates. That's it. I'm 100%. Getting skates. I mean, I'm getting skates. I'm not going to lie. I was one of those people.
Yeah.
But it is such a fun thing to do. And obviously, I used to do it with you guys a little bit before. And it is such a fun. And it's crazy because it's like exercise. It's fun. And it's so social. Like, you meet so many people.
Exactly.
But yeah, anyway, that's not what the episode's about today. We talk about skating all day. But yeah. Because I heard someone, and I asked you this question. They asked, are we made for monogamy or polygamy?
Interesting, because you would like to think that humans are meant to be, you know, you have your one person, you're meant to be monogamous, but it's crazy because there are some people that generally are able to conduct a polygamous relationship.
Yeah.
The one person that kind of comes to mind, mm-hmm. and I don't know if you know this guy, his name is DeRay Davis. He's a comedian.
No, I don't know.
So there's a comedian called DeRay Davis, right? Mm-hmm. He's actually really funny, some light skinned guy, yeah? And like, he has two girlfriends, innit?
Really?
Yeah, like, genuinely, like, two girlfriends.
Yeah.
And they all, like, live
all together.
Yeah, yeah. Like, that's like their thing, innit?
Mm.
And when I first saw that, I was like, what? Like, how? Like, I could not comprehend it. Like, how? First of all, why do you need more than one person?
That's a good question.
You know what I'm saying? Like, why? Second of all, how are they cool with that whole setup?
Mm.
Like, how does it work? Like, and, you know, they seem to be happy. Like, they are able to get along. They're doing their thing. I suppose everyone's different. Me personally, I think it's just one person in it. You have your one person, you settle, have your kids and live a happily ever after. I don't think you need to then have multiple.
Yeah, see, okay. Let me give a disclaimer here, guys. Okay, because I know that a lot of people are gonna have a lot to say.
It's kind of a hot topic.
Yeah,
though,
it is
right?
a hot topic. First of all, let me say this, for the 15th time this podcast, but as a Bible believing Christian, I believe the Bible is inherent truth. I believe that we are made for one person. I do think that was God's design. I do think that's God's will. And I personally choose to believe that. I know some people are of different beliefs. I know other people are different, of different faiths. I'm not here to offend anyone. That is my personal belief.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in this discussion, as I unpack it, it might sound like I'm of wavering belief. I believe what I believe, but I do think it's more complex or more nuanced than just this is truth, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Because truth is truth, but the things that the context that surrounds it is still there. Do you get what I mean?
Okay.
And I think it is important as Christians, because I don't want other Christians listening to this to think, where is she going? I thought you're a Christian. What are you trying to say here? I do believe what I believe, but I do think it's important to have this conversation. I think it's important to highlight that this is something that we are seeing in society, and why is it that people feel like they need or want or just are intrigued by multiple relationships. And we're not just talking about sleeping with people, because I feel like there is a difference. Do you get what I mean? I feel like some people just sleep with, you know, they might be an open relationship, and it might be that this is the person you're in a relationship with, and then this is the person that, and then you might have a few other people that you're sleeping with. Either way, I think that's
or like right. a side thing.
Yeah, like a side thing. But their wife's sort of the knowledge. You know, people are in open relationships.
Oh, right. Okay.
I'm not of the belief that that's correct either, but I'm just saying that that's a thing. But then there's also people that are actually polygamous.
I think that's the word.
Yeah. And that's actually, I think now a sexual orientation, I believe. I'm not sure if that's the right word. But so... Personally, like I said, I'm a Christian, so I believe in monogamy. I believe that we're made for one person, not as in we're made for one, there's the one, but as in we're made to be with one person.
Mm-hmm.
But I do find it interesting because actually it was funny, like last year, I was watching Insecure, which first of all, that show has got a lot of sex in it. Like I was literally like, I stopped watching it. I was like, this is too much for me. Nah. I'm not getting into this. But literally every episode, I was like, there's like three sex scenes. It's like power. Like, you know, the whole show, you're like, is it an actual show or is it just like soft porn? Like literally. But what was I gonna say? So yeah, in it there's a girl, sorry to ruin it, spoilers for anyone that's watching it, but there's a woman who who's basically, she's known this guy for her whole life since they were growing up, and she knows that he's married, and then one day he starts moving to her, and then she's like, but yo, haven't you got a wife? And he's like, oh yeah, but we're in an open marriage or whatever. The term open marriage is an oxymoron. Can I just say, isn't it? That is an oxymoron. It does not make sense. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't, like, actually does not make sense. Yeah. Like, doesn't, like, if you look at what the term word marriage actually means, that doesn't make sense. But anyway, not here to judge anyone. But he was like, I'm in an open marriage. And then you see that kind of unfold. You see them two kind of doing their little thing. It wasn't just sex, though. There was kind of some level of intimacy. And he was kind of showing up to a few family functions. Like, it was an actual relationship. Do you get what I mean? And that was the thing until she went to a party. Now, I haven't watched the end, so I don't know how it ends. It's for everyone that has seen how it ends. But she went to a party and his wife was there. And when she saw them together again, the wife knew about her. It's not that the wife didn't know. Yeah. When she saw them together again is when she realised that's who he's really in a relationship with.
Yeah.
Now, it's really interesting because of, also for people that don't know, I should have actually defined it. What I wrote down in my notes, just a quick definition of what monogamy and polygamy is, because not everyone will know what that is. Sorry. Basically, monogamy is when you are dating exclusively one person or married to one person. Polygamy is when you are with more than one person or in a relationship with more than one person. I don't know everything about the topic, so don't look at me and be like, oh, you're missing this or you're missing that. I don't know everything about it. I'm not here claiming that I do. This is just a casual kind of conversation. But I don't know. I find it really interesting. And I was thinking the other day, when did I first... Because with monogamy, it's just ingrained in Western society. Like, it's not something that you think of or you learn about. It's just something that exists. Like,
it's just a given, right?
It's just a given within Western society. But polygamy, I actually remember learning about it in school in RE, where you'd see these tribes where they have one man with multiple wives, or you'd learn about Islam and how people are allowed up to four wives or whatever the custom is. And it was like crazy, you know? It's like, how is this allowed?
That's where it comes down to sort of the culture side of it.
Culture, right? Then it made me really think, it's like our belief or understanding of relationships really not really inherent, but more society, bit like more nurtured than nature, basically. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
And I do think that I do think it's quite interesting, because then when I try to think of this as a Christian, I think, what is true? Because naturally women can only, like, for example, women can only be impregnant one time a year, for example, but men can continuously have kids without a limit. Do you get what I mean? Until a crazy amount of age. It doesn't even match. So then I was like, feeling like, why did God do it like this? To be honest, the Bible says in Genesis, let me actually read the actual, because you know, everyone, I always paraphrase in the podcast. That it's like, actually paraphrase the Bible.
I actually want to hear this.
But it says, let me find it. It says, therefore, man shall leave his father and his mother, hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. That gives off the impression we're made for one person. So that then says, okay, that's God's design for us. But it is interesting that that's God's design, but then he made us biologically different in that way. Do you get what I mean? Mm-hmm. Which I do think is quite interesting. And then, like I said, later on in the Bible, you see people in polygamous relationships. Like, the first person to come to mind is like Solomon, who had like something like 400 wives and like 700 concubines.
Oh my days.
And that's literally what the Bible says. It's not like we're making this up. Like, this is literally what it says. So it's crazy. People think, how can you have 7,500? How could you sleep with that many people? And that's what I'm saying. But then people, but like, obviously with Bible times, the reason why polygamy was allowed, and just to clear this up, was because of the society they lived in, women weren't regarded as highly, obviously. Okay. So if they weren't married,
yeah.
if they weren't children and they weren't married, they were either prostitutes or slaves often.
Okay.
Or they just died. Like, literally just died of starvation or lack of protection and this stuff. So literally, men would marry multiple women to kind of like balance that out. Do you get what I mean? So that women would be kind of accounted for.
Okay.
So that's kind of the reasoning, for as far as my research has gone, as to why there were so many polygamous relationships in the Bible. Now, why there was an imbalance in women to men, I don't know.
But do you know what, yeah? But saying that, and this is kind of what the whole issue with, you know, polygamy and monogamy may be, because if you've got someone who has multiple wives, and that, you know, those wives all have kids, like, how are you able, realistically, to be a father figure to all of those different kids? And as we know, like, in kind of like, you know, Western society and like, modern day 2021, children need their fathers. And like, we've seen it where like there's, you know, you got your broken homes or whatever, the father's not around, and then that leaves, you know, the child with their own kind of, I don't know how to word it, but like their own kind of, I suppose, trauma. Yeah, can you call it trauma?
Yeah.
Or that kind of, okay, like my mom is my mom and my dad. Like, my dad never loved me. Or, what's it? They got daddy issues. I think people call it daddy issues.
Daddy,
Daddy issues or whatever it might be. So I feel like as a man, like, you need to be there for your kids, innit? And you can't be there for your kids if you have multiple wives and they all have children. Like, how are you able to genuinely, like, in yourself, give those kids the amount of time that they need to be able to say, okay, great, this is how you, you know, this is how you show your love to another person, or this is how you, you know, be the man that you need to be, or this is what a man should be like. Do you understand? There's a lot of times where people don't really know how to love because they haven't seen it from their parents, for example. You know, and you need your father and your mother both to be able to, you know, show that love. Okay, great, they will show that love to you. But it's like, how do you see it? You know, I know the kind of love that I want is going to be, you know, a replica of how I see my parents or how I see my grandparents show their love to each other. Do you know what I mean? And if your father is not around to do so, it's going to be quite hard to naturally pick that up. You know,
I do agree. I do think there is a need for present parents, always. That's always the truth. But even parenthood aside, like, for me personally, I just think, like, the whole idea of a relationship is that there's a person that has exclusive access to you in a way that no one else does. They are, and the way that the Bible is describing it when he's saying one flesh is, they basically become you. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
And that, like, let me even, because Timothy Keller, he phrases love well in his book, The Reason for God. He basically says, love is the most liberating freedom loss of all. One of the principles of love is that you have to lose some form of independence in order to experience greater intimacy. You cannot experience love to its greatest extent if you continue to live life making unilateral decisions and allowing your friend or lover to have no say. To experience the joy and freedom of love, you must to some extent give up your personal autonomy. And I feel like it's true. Like, to love, it's weird to, you have to give up yourself to gain, if that makes sense. And I feel like that idea of loving multiple people, like, you couldn't have that deep element of that, like, you must hold something back in doing that because you couldn't be giving your full self to everyone, if that makes sense. In that sense, like, the idea is that, from, like I said, from the Bible at least, is to become one flesh, is to become like the same person, batty and bench or whatever. Do you get what I mean? And the relationships I've seen that are healthy marriages are like that. Do you get what I mean? Like, super close, super, like, you know, literally best friends. And like I said, I don't like to be the person that says there's one way to love, you know, there's only one way for people to be in relationships. But in reality, the whole idea of that, of a relationship or and marriage especially, is that, like I said, that person has unlimited access to you that nobody else does.
No one else does.
And so isn't that going directly against what a relationship is? So why are we labeling it a relationship? That to me just sounds like and this might be because of a lack of knowledge, of understanding, but like, you know, really intimate friendships with sex. Do you get what I mean? Like, intimate friendships with sex. Like, that's not, and that's not the same thing. People often think relationships are just intimacy with sex, but that's not actually what they're supposed to be, you know? And I think that's why we have such a warped understanding in 2020 of what a relationship is.
2021.
Oh my gosh. Last year was like a blink. So I keep forgetting it. But yeah, that's what I personally think. But wanted to go on, to go into that a bit deeper then. Like, and I want to kind of touch on a few things from like a non-Christian perspective. Then I want to go into, as a Christian, what I think, even though I've kind of dropped it here and there. But why, if polygamy and open relationships are a thing, do men still, and women, get into relationships and then cheat? That one, I don't...
Yes, it's a bit mad, isn't it?
I don't understand. If you don't want to be with one person, then what? Like, I don't understand that. And obviously, as a Christian, I'm not talking about from a Christian perspective, we already know the answer to this, but I'm just saying, like,
the only thing I can think of, right, is if you like someone, and you know that you're into having multiple partners or whatever it might be, the person that you like, or that you lust for, they may not be into that. And as the bad person that you may be, you may lie to that person and try to get into that relationship just to get
get
that particular person, with the intention of, okay, I've got that person, I'm going to try and, you know, cheat and do it with other people as well. That's coming from, you know, not being honest, not being faithful, and you know, not making their intentions clear. Obviously, cheating is wrong, and that's where the whole communication side of things, you know, come into play. From what I was saying from before, if you're able to communicate what you're looking for, or what your, you know, what your expectations are, then surely that would avoid people from cheating.
Yeah.
People still get into these relationships knowing that, you know, you're gonna cheat, but you want to get that person. You're being selfish. That's literally what it is. It's selfish, isn't it? You want that particular person. You're getting in a relationship with them, but you know, my head's somewhere else as well. Like, I'm going to be looking for other things. Like, it's wrong, man.
I think it's wrong. It doesn't make sense. And I feel like, when I deep that, wait, hold on, there's been another option this whole time. I was like, why are people doing this to each other? But I do also think sometimes people cheat unintentionally, I say. Because everything's intentional, so you can't really say it's unintentionally. But, you know, sometimes they don't expect it, especially with emotional cheating. Like, you start talking to someone online, you don't think it's going to turn into that. It just does somehow. Do you get what I mean? Right. You just end up there. And I'm not saying that's okay. And that's never... And nothing is unintentional. Like, you chose to pick up your phone and to text. I'm not saying it's... But people somehow find themselves in this place. And ultimately, it's just... It's wrong. But I do think it's interesting. I also wanted to say that... Oh, where is it? I was going to say something else about this. I wrote it down. Someone actually said this, and this was another podcast. I watch a lot of podcasts, obviously. There was a husband and a wife, and they were talking, and then he was basically saying, like, I don't get why women, like, get in relationships with men, like, say, yeah, we're cool, we're chill, like, yeah, it's nothing, yes, I want something casual too. They don't really, but they say that. Then the guy gets in a relationship with them, then they're a bit more like, no, you know, I don't want you doing this, I don't want you doing that, I don't want you, like, you know, and it becomes serious, and the guy's like, okay, I actually like this girl, so, you know, I'll stick with it, I'll stay with her. So then they stay together, then, you know, they do the thing, they get married or whatever, they go down the right path, you know, like, you know, okay, cool, this is where we're at. Just for the woman to not meet his needs sexually. Do you get what I mean? Like, in the sense of, are women, like, a lot of women put pressure on men to get into marriage or to marry them, if that makes sense. It's, yeah. And then they don't meet their needs physically once they're married. And then he's like, then why did you force me into a marriage if you weren't going to meet the needs that I have? Do you get what I mean? Because now I feel kind of trapped, if that makes sense. Like, and I thought it was an interesting point. Like, I don't necessarily agree with it, obviously, but I thought it was just an interesting point, you know, because I do see a lot of girls kind of like, yeah, like definitely like marriage. Do you get what I mean? And then obviously some guys are just not.
Can you just touch on that a bit again? So you're saying when women
So basically the idea is when women pressure men into marriage,
doing something,
marriage, specifically, and then don't meet their needs sexually. So if a guy is like, okay, let's be a bit more casual because he wants to entertain himself with other women,
okay,
but then this person's like, oh, but to be with me, you have to marry me and shut yourself off. So because he wants to be with that person, he does that, but then only to find that his needs aren't met.
Yeah, that's really sad, you know. Oh God, I'm sorry. Is not funny. Yeah,
it was the whimper.
Oh God.
Oh my God.
I'm sorry. That is really not funny. But I don't know, man. Like, first of all, I think the issue here is, you know, trying to pressure someone into doing something that they don't want to do.
It's just silly. Yeah.
Do you get what I mean? So from there, you've made your mistake. By putting the pressure on the guy, okay, if you want to do that, you know, we have to get married. Like, that's not what marriage is.
Yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying? That's not what it's meant to be. So why are you forcing that person or pressuring them into doing something like that? Like, everything's kind of going to go downhill from that point.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, are you going to be surprised if that person then ends up, you know, seeking alternative...
things. Not that validates it. That's still wrong.
Or maybe even deciding, you know what, this isn't for me, and then getting a divorce.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like putting the man in that kind of situation of having to make that decision is wrong. You need to... The whole idea of, you know, like you said, for getting married is because you love that person, or for whatever it is, you want to be together. You see yourself long-term building with that person, right? Cool. If that isn't your reasons for getting married, and you're getting married just because you're, you know, you lust for that person, you've made your mistake right there already. That's it. It's done.
I think it's true. I agree.
But then again, it's kind of wrong for the man to agree to that as well.
Yeah, both sides.
It's both sides. Both sides. It's not just the woman. It's kind of both sides.
It's crazy to say that is happening right now in society. Do you get what I mean? What he was saying is the truth. Like, it does probably happen a lot. Like, women pressure men into this, like, you know, this covenant, you know, just to not... And I'm not saying that now women must give themselves up, like, because, like I said, it's supposed to be self-sacrifice. And so you're not always going to get everything you need. Like, there is a level of balance to this. It's not... you know, about everyone's needs, you know, but it is at the end of the day, because when you get married, what it's supposed to be is that you're giving your body over and they're giving theirs over. It's an exchange almost, literally. Like, so it was an interesting point. I thought it was interesting. Like I said, what I also do think is quite interesting, kind of a jump here, but all this poly stuff, feel like it's all very well in open relationships for men in a patriarchal society, but for women this looks very different. Do you get what I mean? Because not a lot of men that I know are gonna want to be with a woman if she's got
a next man
that she wants to be with. Do you get when a guy is trying to convince a girl, like, don't worry about your man, like, come, like, do you know what I mean? That's different. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, like, oh, that's your man, but I'm just the side not a lot of guys like to be the side thing.
Yeah.
Do you get what I mean? They like to have a side thing. But they don't like to be thought of as the side thing. Do you get what I mean? So how does this work for women? And also, like, even I was watching this... Well, I wasn't even watching. I watched a clip on Instagram of the Sweetie thing with Justin Combs or whatever. And they literally said... What was it they said? They said something like... Sorry, this is very random. This is like on threesomes. But they were basically saying two girls and one guy is a threesome. Two guys and one girl is a train. And I deeped. Like, people have a very different perspective of when women are sexually involved with more than one person than when men are. Do you get what I mean? And it's just patriarchy. It's just the society that we live in. We know this already. But it's like, okay, it's all well and good if we're in a marriage and you say, an open marriage, I should say, and you say, all right, cool, let's do our thing. But it's going to look
double standards,
right? Yeah.
I think generally speaking, people would see women as, oh, they're only meant to have one man. But then it's okay for, like, a man to have multiple women. And I don't obviously agree with that. I think it's wrong. But unfortunately, this is just society and the world that we live in today. Yeah. And that's why for a woman to be polygamous.
Yeah.
I don't know how to say the word. Okay. So just allow me, right? But for women to be like that, it's going to have its negative connotations with it.
Already.
Because she's a woman, unfortunately. Mm. And, like, you will say, oh, like, no, maybe she's a hoe. Or, I'm not saying this is what I believe, but people will be like, oh, yeah, like, she's a hoe. Like, she's got more than one man. Da, da, da. But if it's a guy, suddenly it's, oh, yeah, like, It's just a guy being a guy, like, it's allowed. Like, nah, like,
yeah,
allow it, man. It really shouldn't be like that, man. It's so sad that there's double standards like that. It's so sad.
Yeah, but I do think it's interesting, and I think that, do you know what's also interesting? I feel like also how would the guy feel compared to the girl? Do you get what I mean? Because like, it could just go so wrong in so many. Imagine your girl gets pregnant by another man,
and you have no idea.
No, you have full idea.
You have every idea.
Because you were the one that agreed to this relationship. You were the one that agreed to this relationship. Now she's pregnant by this man over here.
But obviously, I can't comprehend that because I will never be in that situation. Yeah. But it's really difficult for me to like even understand it. But man, I suppose there must be people that are okay with it though. There must be guys because they be living that life. Yeah. That'd be their life. Like they be living in them kind of situations.
But boy, that's mixed, man.
I just think generally, like the guy is meant to be the guy. Mm. Like, oh, I'm the guy. Like I got bare things. Or he doesn't want to be, like you said, he doesn't want to be seen as
the side thing.
As a side thing.
Mm. And imagine looking like the side thing in your own marriage.
Jeez.
Gosh.
Oh my God. Okay. Okay.
I'm nervous.
That obviously leads on to like, I don't know if you heard of things like where they have like, what's it called? Like couples exchange and things like that. Or they do like swingers. And that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah, I've heard about this before.
So that's like where, like, let's say, like,
Two married couples,
like, they swap and do these kind of things. Where does that kind of fall into this conversation?
There's one thing this life, you never say you will never do something, yeah, because you just never know. Yeah, I don't know where life will take me. But please, Lord, let me never, ever involve myself in that kind of activity. Do you know how mad that is?
That's just not happening.
For me, personally, at least.
It's not happening, man. But
I don't know what bit is worse, me sleeping with you, this random man, or you sleeping with her. How dare you? Like,
or you two's both agreed to that.
And how do you sit down and have like, hey, over dinner, hey babe, how's your day? Yeah, it was cool. It's at the office. How's your day? Yeah, it was cool. I had this idea.
I think they must have already spoken about it. Like,
yeah,
that might have already been like one of their, I don't know, their sexual fantasies or one of those ones. Like, that might be one of the things that they're just into, innit?
Yeah. Not to judge anyone as well. We're not here to judge. This is not a judgment thing. This is just a conversation. But it does lead me on to my next, what I wanted to go into next, which is just like, I do think there are some general like lies that we believe in society about relationships, especially when it pertains to marriage and more serious relationships, which I don't think are healthy. I've actually written them down. My notes, it looks all weird. Sorry guys, sorry about this. Dun, 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 dun. Okay, this is them. The first one, yeah, I was listening, once again, I was watching another podcast.
Yeah.
And they were talking about the green light method in marriage, which is when you give your partner one green light to sleep with another person. You don't know anything about it, you don't know when it takes place, you don't know, like, you don't know the details, but they have one green light to cheat.
Raw! Is this real?
Like, I heard about it on a podcast. Actually, listened to it like months ago. I can't even remember.
No, it's cool. The green light, yeah.
Well, I don't know if it's got the name, but like that's what they were using in the podcast to refer to it. And for me personally, like, obviously I personally wouldn't get involved in that, but I thought it's crazy, because what you're essentially saying is, I will allow you at some point to step out of this marriage as long as I don't know about it. Like, ignorance is bliss.
And, okay, go, carry on.
No, that's all I wanted to
say. I was just going to say, like, how do you know? Because if you're not going to know, how are you going to know that that's going to be one? Do you get what I'm saying? This person could be under this green light multiple times and you would never know.
The first time didn't count because she didn't know. The next time didn't count.
Do you get what I'm saying? Or do you, like, disclose, okay, I've used my green light now. Yeah. Like, what? That doesn't make sense, man.
I just think it's silly. And it goes back to the idea of what marriage is supposed to be. It's like, it's an oxymoron to say this. You can step out of our marriage. The vows that people say on their wedding day are death-breaking vows. Mm. Like, that's the only way out of this. Do you get what I mean? That means the only thing that can separate you is death.
To a death do us part, right?
Literally. So That means if we're one flesh, biblically, if we're one flesh and you go sleep, we've gone and slept with another person. Do you get what I mean? Because you've invited them into our marriage bed. Do you get what I mean? This marriage is now no longer a two-person thing. Do you get what I mean? We're no longer one. Do you get what I mean? So I just think that's just so crazy. And I do think it's a lie that is being put into society. That's okay as long as we don't know about it. Cheat is okay as long as we don't know about it. I think that's a lie. I think that's, and it's not okay because that is not a relationship then. That's just not a relationship. I don't understand. That's just, you're just labeling something that isn't something else. Do you get what I mean?
You can't call it, you can't then call it a marriage.
Like that's what I mean. That's not a marriage. If that makes sense. And then the other one I wanted to mention was it's okay to, this idea of like having work relationships. Like,
like a work husband.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Do you know?
Interesting.
How many people sleep with their work spouses, wives and husbands? I'm not even joking. The statistics are mad. Like, you know, people admitted to it. Like, not to their partner, but like in surveys. Or that they would do it if the opportunity arose.
I think that comes down to, I'm not saying it's okay or whatever. I'm just saying, it probably comes down to the length of time that you spend
with that person.
With that person
because
that's work.
Why, and that's why I personally think that they're wrong. Because you're going to be spending a considerable amount more intentional time, I should say, with that person. Like, if you're married to someone and you're living with them, yeah, but you might be at home but being doing two different things. Like, you could be playing your Xbox, she could be making dinner, or, do you know what I mean? Or watching YouTube, something completely different, yeah? But in work, if you're both actively working on stuff together, and I know not all work relationships are like that, but I feel like it's mad to say, yeah, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, that can be, they can be checking for you, they can be looking after you, they can be bringing you in food. Do you get what I mean? And for most people, like I said, it does end up being more than that, or it spirals into more than that. So that's actually, I personally just don't, like, if I'm married, oh, I have a husband, I don't want him having a work wife.
No, man.
Literally, like, I don't want him to.
He's
still cheating. Because it's cheating. What's the difference between that and emotional cheating? Do you get what I mean? And this everyone in work knows that's your guy. And then it's awkward at the work Christmas do when you bring me there. Because everyone's, and you've got banter with this other babes.
I love it.
It's crazy.
And
it's
everyone's crazy. Looking at you like,
who's she?
Long.
And you know how many people I know that are jealous of the person at work or the woman at work that their husband works with just because, you know, insecurities. And everyone has insecurities, isn't it? And if they have all the things that you don't have, you're going to be like, do you get what I mean?
Yeah, man.
Craziness.
If you're working like a normal, sort of like a 9 to 5 effectively, you are going to spend more time at work than you are typically at home. Obviously, this whole new way of working with working from home and things like that is different. Yeah. But I'm saying, like, but how things used to be sort of pre-COVID, if you was working in the office, you're going to spend more time with your colleagues than you are at home. Because as soon as you go home, all right, you might have your dinner, have a quick chat, but you're going to go to sleep, then you're back to work the next day. Do you know what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
It's hard, man. It's hard.
The other one I wanted to talk about was this idea of sex in marriage. And this is the main one. The three of them are made up of this. One, the idea that you need something external to spice up your marriage. Do you get what I mean? It's kind of like the green light method, where people feel like you need something. I think that's, sorry to use dramatic term here, but I really think it's a lie from the pit of hell. Like, the idea of taking something external, because once again, going back to what marriage is supposed to be, a relationship is supposed to be, it's supposed to be this exclusive access to you. And if you don't feel like, if you're looking to something external to yourselves to make something inter, that doesn't make sense. Do you get what I mean? Because you're like, it's like you're trying to fill a void almost. Do you get what I mean? And it's like the lack of ability to try and work it out. It's like you've already made up your choice.
Can I ask you something?
Yeah.
When you say an external thing, do you mean
a person?
Yeah. Okay, I just wanted to establish.
Yeah. Sorry. Sorry, a person.
External.
I mean, a person. Sorry, you know when people are like, oh yeah, like a threesome to spice up.
Right. The marriage. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's that ain't it.
That ain't it.
That ain't it. Mad thing. Sorry, I thought you was, you know, just meaning external things.
No, not that. Like, obviously, they say that the marriage bed is undefiled. So anything, that's what the Bible says. Anything y'all doing that marriage bed between you and the Lord. but at the same time, like, I do think, like, I
just disagree with that altogether. Like, why would you need that two spice? Like, why would you need an external body?
But it's this whole idea of to spice up. Really, a marriage isn't always going to be spicy. Do you get what I mean? And like I said, it's better you find something within each other to spice it up. Because when does that end? When does it end? Okay, you do this now. You're married for 20 years. You do this now. What happens when you're married at 40 years and it's dry again? How many times do you do this?
Do you do that?
And then what about when that gets boring? Because like anything, it gets boring. So now what?
What now? My thing.
Anyway, I think that's another. And another one was when sex becomes the core component for whether a marriage is healthy. Like, people judge how healthy their marriage is based on how much sex you're having. Do you know why that's lethal? Because like anything in life, there's going to be seasons. So if you're going through a dry patch, if you feel like, okay, and also I want to make it clear, I'm not married. I've never been married. I don't know what it's like to be married. So this is obviously from a single person's perspective.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, when I talk about marriage, I'm kind of talking about relationships too, in general. Do you get what I mean?
Okay.
But I believe in the Bible. And so when I say relationships, I'm more talking about relationships with the intent of marriage. Do you get what I mean? But when people are like, I also kind of tend to see this with guys, like, not to judge guys, but obviously they may feel like they're not having enough sex, or some women also feel like that too. They just feel like, oh, okay, this person isn't meeting my needs, as if that's one need, but they're meeting every other need. But because this is to you the core component of, oh, this is the most important thing to me, it blinds you to all the other things. Do you get what I mean? And if you define whether a marriage is healthy or not, or a relationship is healthy or not, by how much sex you're having, then when things are dry, like you've just had kids, or there's a lot going on, or maybe someone's going through a grief, or, you know, whatever, then what? Like, we're not good. Do you get what I mean? And I feel like it's just toxic. Do you get what I mean?
That's the word. It's literally toxic.
Yeah, but the way that society builds it up on social media, it's so much that sex. Are you having it? Are you having enough? Like, this is how much a healthy person should have. Do you get what I mean?
But there's so much more to a genuine relationship than just sex.
Yeah.
And you said something earlier about, you know, that person meant to be your best friend, like you're supposed to speak to that person about something. That person meant to be there for you to, you know, have a shoulder to lie on.
Yeah.
You know, someone there to support you when you're going through, I don't know, you might be going through some personal things, and like, you got that person that you have a shoulder to cry on.
Yeah.
You know? Without having any sex, that person is your person.
Yeah.
And you can't judge your relationship based off that. Just one small aspect.
Yeah.
I don't know how big you want to call it, but just have that one aspect to say that your whole relationship is not good because, okay, you're not having that much sex at the moment, or the sex isn't great right now, like whatever it might be. No, man, I think we've really just got to try and look at this thing from a mature perspective.
Yeah, definitely.
If you're only judging it by the sex, and really, like, you're not doing yourself any justice.
The last one I wanted to mention was just that people often are of the belief that relationships, marriage, are supposed to fulfill you, like, and that you're never gonna have any unmet needs in them. Do you get what I mean? They're of this belief, and I think this is very common, and people don't communicate it, they don't think about it as much, because they have this idea that, oh, but when I get married, that's going to be accounted for. When I get married, this is going to be accounted for. Like, I won't need to worry about sex anymore because I'll have it with that person. Do you know what I mean? Don't need to worry about who's going to do this for me because I'll just have my husband do it. Like, it's this idea that once you get married, there's no other needs that there's no needs that should be unmet. Do you get what I mean? This idea that this marriage should completely fulfill you. Do you get what I mean? But the thing that people forget is that there's always going to be holes. Do you know what I mean? Because we're not made to be fulfilled here on earth. God has already said that the only thing that can fulfill us is Him. Do you get what I mean?
Okay.
So if we're made to have a hunger for something more, you know, and I said this in one of my other podcasts, I think it's C.S. Lewis that writes, if you find yourself with a gaping hole, like a need for something more, that's because you're still on the wrong side of heaven. Do you get what I mean? You're still waiting to get there. And I think we're built to need God. Do you get what I mean? If we felt like we had everything, we would think in and of ourselves that we are gods. Do you get what I mean?
Okay. I never thought of it like that.
You know, because we would need nothing. Imagine not needing anything from anyone. Mm. That would be a weird way to live life. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
But if we are to understand the weight of who God is, we have to see that we're insufficient without him. Do you get what I mean? And so when people feel like, oh, my marriage should fulfill me, they're putting their marriage on the same pedestal as God. You know?
Okay.
So when you put a relationship on a pedestal of God and you say this thing doesn't fulfill me, then yeah, you're going to look into being polygamous and open relationships and spicing things up because I'm trying to fill this hole that is supposed to remain void. Do you get what I mean? It's because we've not met the person that fulfills that thing. Do you get what I mean? Because why would we need God if everything we needed was here? We wouldn't care about heaven. Do you get what I mean? We wouldn't care about anything eternal. Like, we have to know we need him. And it's not just in relationships, in every aspect of life. Aspect. When your intelligence runs, when you feel like, oh, why can't I get this? Or why can't, like the other day, I did a maths assessment, yeah, because I had to do one for work. And I was terrible at maths in school. And I thought, maybe by now, I would have got better at it, you know? I thought maybe I've, these general kind of percentages I'm working off when I buy and sell items. Maybe I've got better at it. Nope, still rubbish at it. Do you get what I mean? Still rubbish at it.
I wasn't expecting that. Still, yeah. I thought you was actually going to say, like,
still had to Google the answers. So when I was doing that, I realized that there's some things where I'm going to hit my limit. But we in a society, instead of saying embrace limits and weaknesses, we say turn to something else to fill that. Do you get me? Do you know what I mean?
Right.
We're not a society that understands that people are people. Do you get what I mean? Like, we are going to have limits. There's only a limit of how much I can do for the people I love in my life. My mum, my dad, my brother, you. Do you know what I mean? Whatever. But instead of us embracing limits in ourselves and in others, and when you fail to do it in yourself, you fail to do it even more in others. When you can't embrace that I can only do so much, then you, like I said, you look to external things to make that gap up instead of looking to God. Do you get what I mean?
Okay.
So that's ultimately what those are some of the lies I think that people are believing in society about relationships, marriage in particular. Yeah.
You've made me think about that in a completely different way, to be honest with you. I think you're right in terms of people putting it on a pedestal, but obviously I don't really identify as a Christian as such, so I wouldn't necessarily generally think of it like that. But like, I totally understand what you're saying, man. At the end of the day, if you're always seeking more, always seeking things, or you put in your this relationship always asking for something more, you're never going to be content. You're never going to be, your mind is never going to be at ease. You're always going to be asking for more. Hence, you said about the whole spicing things up. You're always going to be asking for it, you know? So you're saying that in life, and this is kind of going aside from relationships, but you're saying like in life, you're never fully going to be content until you later rest and go to heaven.
I think that,
or do you just find peace with not having everything?
I think that no one, Christians, non-Christians, anyone, can believe that there will be a time in their life that they have everything. So contentment comes in knowing that and embracing your present moment. Do you get what I mean?
Fine.
I would say I'm the most content I've ever been in life right now. I was actually telling my friends this yesterday on the phone. I'm like another level, the way that like my life is right now. I feel like in every aspect, I'm fully content. But in every aspect, I'm not getting everything I want. Do you know what I mean? I'm not made $1 million yet. So I'm not like, I'm not achieved that, but I've still found contentment that I know I have potential to. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
So I think contentment's more perspective as opposed to destination. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the way that I see it is I do think you are fully whole in eternity. I don't think you even know yourself enough. Do you get what I mean? Because if you think about it, if God created us, he knows us better than we do. The machine that's made knows itself less than the person that made it, if that makes sense. Like, if a car is made,
I get what you're saying.
The person that made the car knows
the ins and outs of the
better car than the car does. So even though it can tell you flash a light on its dashboard to say something's wrong, it can't tell you why it's wrong. Do you get what I mean? The person that made it can though. So I don't think we're fully whole until we're with our creator. Do you get what I mean? But I do think there is an extremely high level of contentment. And God says in the Bible, you will see the goodness of the Lord here on the land of the living, which means we don't have to wait till heaven to see God's full goodness. Do you get what I mean? We can experience it. We do have access to it here, you know? But I do believe that the wholeness that you can find is reserved for heaven. Yeah.